Man, what is up, America? What's up to the entire globe, man? So good to see y'all. Thank y'all for coming to this beautiful live event. We got so many people in the house, man. We got people. Let's see, we got people from India, all the way from India to Canada. We got folks in the States here from Kentucky and my home state of Missouri. I'm in North Carolina right now. Shout out to North Carolina, Washington. I hope everyone is safe and healthy and doing well. It's so good to see you guys. For everyone who may or may not be familiar with who I am children's book author Derrick Barnes, and I've been in this business for 16 years now, man. Y'all see all the gray on my beard. Been in this business for 16 years. And I have maybe 12 published titles. My most popular books are the Ruby and the Book of Boys series, published by Scholastic, Crown and Ode to the Fresh Cut, and The King of Kindergarten. Again, I live in Charlotte, North Carolina, married to my college sweetheart, Dr. Tinka Barnes. We've been married for 21 years, and we have four amazing sons, the mighty, 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 mighty Barnes brothers, Ezra, Solo, Silas, who's the cover boy for Crown, and my baby Nambi. He's not a baby, but he's 9 years old. He's the baby of the bunch. So, yeah, I'm just so happy to be here, guys, and today I'm going to be sharing with you my latest book. It came out in September. And it has really touched my heart. It's really done a lot for my career. I've transitioned into thinking about, and I think every artist should think about this. And I know there's a lot of artists and would-be artists watching right now. Who is your target audience and who are you creating for? And so I think about boys like my four sons and what kind of books would they like to read. I think about when I grew up, there weren't a lot of books that I could find and see where the cover looked like me. I couldn't go in a bookstore or a library and see a book with a boy that looked like me. And so I always want to center African-American boys from all over the world and put them in the most universal stories that everybody can relate to, because everybody wants to be the star of the show. And so with this book that I'm going to be reading to you guys today, I Am Every Good Thing, illustrated by the amazing Gordon C. James, who's the illustrator. And this is his son, Gabriel, on the cover. And just to give you a little bit of background before I read to you, the book was written as a poem in 2018. We were right in the middle of the Crown and Ode to the Fresh Cut tour. And there was an ad that came out. It was an international ad by a huge clothing company. And they had a little black boy, a little African, beautiful African boy with a green hoodie on it. And on the hoodie, it said, "The coolest monkey in the jungle." And if you know anything about American racial, the history of this country in regards to race, monkey has always been a negative racial epithet and stereotype to degrade and put down African Americans. So I obviously this term has been used all over the planet, not just in America, but I thought about my four sons and I thought about how I hold them up and how much I love them and how much goals and dreams I have for them and how I view them. I view them as young kings, definitely not as the coolest monkey in the jungle. So I wrote this poem filled with all the good things that anybody can think about and all these positive things that I think about when I think about my sons. And I just wanted to write a poem where no matter where you live, if you may or may not be blessed enough to have black boys in your immediate life, you do have friends, brothers, cousins, sons, nephews, And I just wanted the world to know that I love and care about my sons the same way that anybody does, no matter what color or race you are, no matter what country you live in. We all care about and love our children equally. So I wrote this poem. And if you don't mind, I would love to share it with you. And afterwards, we're gonna take a huge group selfie. And so you guys can share it later on. And I'm also gonna answer any questions you might have. I'm usually an open book when it comes to Q&A. So you can ask about my writing career, ask about writing, you can ask any questions you want about the book, anything, okay? So if you guys are ready, I'm gonna share this book with you, the 2020 Kirkus Prize winning New York best-selling book, I Am Every Good Thing. I dedicate this book to the memory of Tamir Rice, Trayvon Martin, E.J. Bradford, Jordan Edwards, Michael Brown, Jordan Davis, and Julian Mallory. And Gordon dedicated the book to his son, Gabriel, and all little brothers like him. Let's get it. I am a nonstop ball of energy, powerful and full of light. I'm a go-getter, a difference maker, a leader. I am every good thing that makes the world go round. You know, like gravity or the glow of moonbeams over a field of brand new snow. I am good to the core, like the center of a cinnamon roll. Yeah, that good. I am skateboard tricks, scrape knees and elbows. But you know what? I am right back on my feet again. I am one eye open, one eye closed, peeking through a microscope, gazing through a telescope, checking out the spaces around me and plotting off those far places I have yet to go, but will. I am a gentleman and a scholar. I am kind and polite, like yes ma'am and yes sir, helping my grandmother to cross the street and saying bless you when a stranger has to sneeze. I'm a cool breeze, a perfect paper airplane that glides for blocks, for miles, forever. I am a roaring flame of creativity. I am a lightning round of questions and a star-filled sky of solutions. I'm an explorer, planting a flag on every square foot of this planet where I belong. I'm a sponge soaking up information, knowledge, and wisdom. Shoot, I want it all, and I am all ears. I am Saturday mornings in the summertime. I am two bounces and a front flip off the diving board. I am hilarious. I am the life of the party. I am that smile forming on your face right now. I'm the boom, bap, boom, boom, bap. When the bass line thumps and the kick drum jumps, I'm the perfect beat, the perfect rhyme, keeping everything on point and always on time. But you already knew that. I am a grand slam, bases fully loaded. I'm a nasty two-handed dunk holding on to the rim just to remind you that I'm still the man. Believe that. I am the undisputed champion. I am a highlight reel of magnificence. I am the celebration, the applause, and the standing ovation. I am victory. I am a brother, a son, a nephew, a favorite cousin, a grandson. I am a friend. I am real. I am tight hugs, a hand to hold, a shoulder to cry on if you have to. I hope you never have to. I am here. Although I'm something like a superhero, every now and then I am afraid. I am not what they might call me, and I will not answer to any name that is not my own. I am what I say I am. I am that sound in the forest when the mighty tree falls. I am waves crashing gently on the shore. I am a force of nature, a miracle, a blessing. I am brave. I am hope. I am my ancestors' wildest dream. I am worthy of success, of respect, of safety, of kindness, of happiness. And without a shadow of a doubt, I am worthy to be loved. I am worthy to be loved. Thank you. And here are some of the accolades for the book. It was a New York Times bestseller. It was an indie bestseller, had 6-star reviews. It was a 2020 Perkins Prize winner and the Charlotte Huck Award, which came from the largest group of English teachers in America, which was a huge honor. It's named Best Book of 2020 by this whole list of publications, including Time Magazine, School Library Journal, the Smithsonian Magazine, New York Public Library. So it's just an extreme honor. And I just wanted to share with you guys, this was my first major book deal. This was my first chapter book series. And I always tell people, I have 4 boys. We don't have any daughters, but Ruby is the only kid that brings money into the house. So this is my baby right here, Ruby and the Booker Boys. It's a 4 book series. I'm extremely proud of this series, and I hope you guys can check it out. Right. Right. Man, so now is the time for us to take a selfie, if you don't mind. So I'm going to hold this book up the right way, and we're going to pose for like 30 seconds. And so when we're done taking this pic, I want you guys to share it. You can go to Flipgrid. You can go to Twitter. Go to @Flipgrid, or you can go to @Scholastic. Okay. And share this pic with your friends. All right. And at me, at Arthur. That's a capital A, Arthur _ capital and all caps DDB. You ready? Here we go. I had to come with different poses, you know. Right, cool. All right, now this is my favorite part. I miss traveling and doing school visits around the country, because I love meeting the people that actually read my books. But this is the next best thing. So this is always my favorite part of the presentation, answering questions. We already have a bunch of questions loaded up here. What's up, Michigan? What's up, New Jersey? In the building. All right. Let's see here. Who's the first one? Miss Raquel, fourth grade class from Lodi, California. Do you have any ideas for your next book? Man, I'm working on 2 books right now. I am actually working on a graphic novel with Gordon C. James, the guy that illustrated Crown and Ode to the Fresh Cut. And I Am Every Good Thing, and we're working on the graphic novel called Do It for the People. And it's where I highlight maybe 15 African-American athletes in American history who use their platforms to fight against, you know, injustices. And I'm working on my first middle grade novel in 10 years, and it's entitled The Incredibly Human Henson Blaze. I don't have any books come out this year, but I'm signing book deals for new books that will be coming out. And I'm also working on my first big animation project. I haven't announced what it is or who I'm working with, so stay tuned. And you can keep up with me at DerrickDBarnes.com. Let me see what else I have. Next year, The Queen of Kindergarten comes out. And I have a book coming out with one of the greatest Olympic athletes of all time. His name is Mr. Tommy Smith. He was once the fastest man in the world. And he ran in the 1968 Olympics. And he made a huge political statement when he won his gold medal. He stood up on that podium and he held his fist up in the air with a black glove. And he was just protesting racism and injustices all over the world. So it was an extreme honor to work with him. Let's see here, Miss Temple's class. Mrs. Temple's class, how long does it take you to write books? It depends on the age group that I'm writing for. So with picture books kind of take me back to the time when I was writing poetry. And it doesn't take that long to write a picture book. Actually, most picture books that you read can probably fit on one sheet of paper. When I'm working on a chapter book, that usually takes me about 3 weeks. When I'm working on a novel or a graphic novel, it usually takes a little bit longer, between 3 to 6 months sometimes. Let's see here. Mrs. Yaz is fourth and fifth grade class. What's up, y'all? What advice do you have for kids who want to be an author? My advice I give to all kids who want to be an author is to continue to read, man. Read every single thing you get your hands on. Read books that you enjoy. Read nonfiction books. Read books of different genres. Read a lot of poetry. Read short stories. And obviously, it's important to read because you expand your vocabulary. You expand your view of the world. But if you want to be an artist, if you want to be a writer, it's important because you are trying to sculpt and create your own voice. Your voice is invaluable. It is important. The world, if you want to be a writer, or if you want to be an illustrator, an artist, the world needs your voice. And you are trying to cultivate and shape that voice. And the only way to do that is to absorb other writing styles. And I'm still trying to be, you know, a better writer. I read constantly, and I read different types of writing in order to add to my own style. So read as much as you can, and also write, because writers write, right? Writers write, right? So read as much as you can and write as much as you can, and just continue to grow as a artist. Mrs. T says, my second graders are wondering if you could share the significance behind your necklace. And they also thank you for this opportunity. Thank y'all for even tuning in, man. I always say it's an extreme blessing. Anytime somebody shows up just to hear you say anything, I never let that, it just never gets old, you know, and I'm just always grateful and thankful that I'm able to write these stories. And I'm even more grateful that you guys tune in and purchase these books. So thank y'all so very much. I always wear African jewelry. So I always wear masculine African jewelry. Obviously, it comes from West Africa. And most of the jewelry I wear, either kings wear, the kings that are the heads of tribes from countries in West Africa. So we're talking about, you know, Ghana and Nigeria. And this one right here, this is actually ivory. This is actually bones. It's yak bones. And the head of tribe that wears this is the head of the family. So if you see somebody wearing this, that means they probably have a lot of yak. They have a lot of children, which I have a lot of children, and they are the head of their household, the head of their tribe. So I have a lot of these, actually. And it's just my thing. I love wearing this African jewelry and just a mark of my heritage and where I come from. What's your favorite book you've read? My favorite book is probably Crown, an Ode to the Fresh Cut, and a middle grade novel I wrote called We Could Be Brothers. I wrote that, came out in 2010. And my favorite book is The Narrative of a Slave, written by Frederick Douglass, who I think is the greatest American of all time. I keep that book on me. Let's see. Miss Skinner's class from St. Pete, Florida. What's up, y'all? Wants to know, how many books have you written in total? I tell you, by the time I wrote 8 books, after that 8th book, it seemed like I couldn't get a book deal at all. Nobody wanted to publish anything from me. I almost considered quitting, but I'm not a quitter and I don't give up. And I know I had to have a greater purpose. So I tell you, between 2011 and 2014, I wrote like maybe 35 books that nobody was asking for. I didn't have any deadlines, serious deadlines. But I just refused to give up. I had too many stories to tell, and I knew that there were people who wanted to hear my voice. So I've written like over 50, 60 books. Maybe they haven't all been published. But again, like I was saying to you guys who are interested in being artists, writers write. Regardless if they become published books or not, you just continue to work on your craft and get better. Who inspires me? My family inspires me more than anybody. My mom inspires me. If it wasn't for her, I wouldn't be what I am today in regards to being a writer. She has always supported my writing. She introduced me to books early. You know, my love of words is because of my mom's, but my family, my 4 sons, and my wife, they motivate me to not only be a better writer, but just to be a better person, a better man, a better husband, a better father, a better friend, a better brother. They just make me want to be better every single day. Amanda, what's up, Amanda? My student Luca would like to ask, what is your greatest writing achievement? I don't know, man. It really hasn't happened yet, because I always set my sights for even bigger things. I've won awards now that I couldn't have imagined winning, like, you know, 10 years ago. But there are things I still want to do. I still want to do animation, still want to do films. I want to win the Newbery medal, which I think I will do, because I'm working on a book right now and it's amazing. The Henson Blaze book I was telling y'all about. Who is the most famous person you've met because of your books? Met a lot of famous people. See, who have I met recently? Jennifer Garner. Drew Barrymore, I met Questlove. I met the entire Bush family, which is nuts. This was years ago. I went down to Florida and hung out with them. And obviously I know a lot of writers. I've been friends with Kwame Alexander for a long time, Jason Reynolds, Jacqueline Woodson, Vanessa Newton, a lot of people. So, yeah. Second graders from Virginia, what is your favorite word? My favorite word is, what word do I tell my sons all the time? I'm like a live-in motivational speaker for my boys. Work. I think work is my favorite word. You know, I get up every morning thinking about how I can be better, and I guess work and effort. Effort. Effort is my favorite word, actually. Write that down. Effort is my favorite word. What kind of student were you in school? Asked Miss Kilpatrick, or Mr. or Mrs. I can't see, the Kilpatrick's 4th grade, Abbott's Creek in Raleigh, North Carolina, not too far from me. I was an excellent student. I was in the gifted and talented program from 3rd grade to the 8th grade. The program ended. They didn't have the gifted and talented in high school. I did the AP classes, but I've always been an excellent student. I used to daydream in class. That was the beginning of me just, you know, writing. I want to be a creative person, but I've always been a pretty good student. Micah in school at home. How you doing, Micah? Hope everything is well. How can kids be anti-racist and work and make sure all kids know they are every good thing? I think the most important thing we can do is educate ourselves. I think a lot of time people seek out information that only fortifies what they already know. But I think it's important that you go outside of your comfort zone and seek out information. Like I always talk about the true history of this country. I'm a big fan of the 1619 Project. You guys look that up. where he talks about how this country is centered around, and this country would not be if it were not for the first African slaves that touched down on American soil in 1619. And it made, you know, slavery, it was free labor for over 250 years from enslaved Africans. And the country ended up being a financial powerhouse because of the transatlantic slave trade. And so we need to talk about that and talk about the effects that it has on American history and American culture and how we got to where we are today. So I think we just need to really seek out information that we don't already know and just be honest about it and try to have open conversations with people that may not look like you without, you know, being defensive or being angry, and ask questions and ask things that you are curious about. And we have to answer questions without being defensive, and just be open and honest. Let me see. How do you start off to write books, and who do you do it with? Johnny, this is from Daniel China. And Johnny says, what's a book you recommend for our students to read, other than yours, of course? We will always purchase those. Thank you, Johnny. Thank you very much. I start off writing by just taking notes. So I think about what's not on the market or what message is not being touched on. You know, for instance, with the Henson Blaze novel I'm working on, it's about pretty much about the ownership of Black bodies and how this country has made a living off of the ownership of Black bodies, is centered around a 13-year-old boy that's a super athlete. And I think about how this country really appreciates sports, but they don't really appreciate, you know, the athletes, and how it really mirrors the slave trade in this country. You know, for instance, in the NFL, over 100% of the owners of all the teams are white men, and over 80% of the players in the NFL are all Black men, and none of them own any team. So that book is kind of centered around that. And so I was like, there aren't any books out that really touch on this issue. And so I wrote a book about it. And a huge inspiration for that book is another novel called Maniac McGee. If you guys haven't read that book, check that book out. Maniac McGee, which kind of rolls into what Johnny asked. Maniac McGee is an awesome book. I think you guys should read that. Anything by Mildred Taylor. I love all of her books. Going back to some of my friends' books, anything by Jason Reynolds and Kwame Alexander. Nick Stone is a talented author. Elizabeth Acevedo, super talented. Renee Watson. I'm a huge fan of hers. So yeah, check out all those books. Kwame Alexander, obviously. Let me see. Mrs. Sidlow's fifth grade class. What's up, y'all? Do you have any writing tips for us? I think the most, I have a ton of writing tips that I can give you. But one thing that I struggled with early on was when I started writing, and I just changed this like maybe 6 years ago. I would write maybe a paragraph or maybe two pages, and then I would go back and read it and do self-editing while I was working. And you have to learn how to separate the creative process with the proofreading and editing process. Those are different sects and different mindsets. So when you're in a creative mode, it's almost like you just dump out everything that's in your imagination, that's in your mind. And don't think about going back and editing. You do that later. But initially, when you're working on something, when you're working on a short story, working on a poem, let everything out. And you go back maybe the next day and look at it and fix things around. I feel like a painter sometimes when I'm working, because I let everything out. When I go back the next day, I'm erasing things, I'm moving things around, I'm adding some color here and there, you know. So let everything out that first time around, and then the second time you go back and do proofreading. So, all right, got time for one more question. See, did I miss anybody up here? I go back to Ms. Peterson's class. It says, what do you do when you get stuck while writing? You know what I do? I get down on the floor. I wish I can, I don't want to get off camera, but we have a gym at my house. It's down, it's near the garage, and we just built it up because of COVID. I don't feel safe going to a gym, so I put a gym in my house. But I have this device that's a push-up machine. So whenever I get stuck, I either put on my favorite music, which is jazz music, because I'm from Kansas City, Missouri, the home of Charlie Bird Parker. If y'all know who he is, look him up. Charlie Parker. I'm a huge fan of John Coltrane, who's from North Carolina. I'm a big John Coltrane fan. He's my favorite artist of all time. I listen to jazz music and I get down and do push-ups. I have a push-up machine that you can put these hand grips in different pegs and it works different parts of your body. And I just try to stay in shape. I am a type 1 diabetic. I've been a diabetic I'm 45 years old. I was diagnosed when I was 10, 35 years. So I try to eat right, exercise, and just clear my mind by just exercising and listening to some of my favorite music. But I rarely have writer's block. There's always something to be written. There's always something to be said. For me, it's just finding space and time. And then I just get to it. I let everything out, you know? So that was the last question, guys. I could do this all day. I love interacting with you guys. I love it. So let's see what are we doing now. Well, first of all, I want to thank y'all for tuning in. I really appreciate y'all again. I'm so humbled by anybody coming to check me out. I never take this for granted. I hope that I continue to be blessed to have an opportunity to write the kind of stories and create the kind of characters that you will enjoy for years to come. Those were some awesome questions. I want you guys to take that selfie. Make sure you post it. Make sure you tag Flipgrid. Let me see. What's the hashtag here? The hashtag is Flipgrid for all. Okay. Capital F on Flipgrid. Capital F and 4 and capital A in all. And make sure you tag Scholastic and Flipgrid. And you can go to Flipgrid if you want to continue this conversation and check out this video. So I want to thank y'all again. I want to thank Flipgrid. I want to thank Scholastic. And I want to thank you all. I hope you guys have a beautiful day. Have a beautiful rest of your week. And take care of yourselves and take care of each other, y'all. Much love. Peace.